Hello everyone, and welcome to a very special interview by Statecraft on India's Middle East policy. We are grateful to have with us today the distinguished former Indian ambassador and accomplished author, Talmiz Ahmad. He has previously served as Indian ambassador to Saudi Arabia, Oman, and the UAE. He has also been the Director General of the Indian Council of World Affairs, and his notable works include Children of Abraham at War and the Islamist Challenge in West Asia. Welcome, Ambassador. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
My first question deals with the increasing bonhomie between India and the Middle East. Relations seem to be reaching an all-time high, especially since you were one of the people who was part of the formative stages of this upward trajectory. What would you say are some of the things New Delhi got right in its Think West policy and that are now providing dividends? And where does it still need to improve in order to expand its role and influence in the region?
Our relationship with West Asia is very substantial, but the unique aspect is that it's a continuous relationship. It's a relationship that did not experience any breaks, though there were changes with regard to the political situation in West Asia as well as South Asia. The relationship has a continuity which is quite extraordinary. Secondly, it's a relationship until the British came, which was at the popular level. It involved people primarily, business people certainly, at various other levels, at the worker level, etc. People were there. So you have a continuity at the popular level again. For example, records will indicate that Indian communities have been living there for more than 1,000 years. And indeed, there are references to Indians in Babylonia and Sumeria and Babylonia, and even in Egypt. So there has been a continuous flow and movement of our people. Secondly, do recall that India was linked with West Asia through the Silk Route, not only the Silk Route and the Spice Route. So both ways, there was a massive movement of people, movement of goods, movement of ideas, movement of religion, movement of philosophy. So there is a continuum. Even when the British came and dominated the region for 200 years, what changed for the British was that there was now a political outreach into the region. As James Onley has written, that indeed the Gulf was an integral part of the British Indian Empire. And the fact is that it was controlled manned by Bombay and later Calcutta and finally Delhi. But the people's connection remained, except that now you had a very large number of Indian armed forces personnel located there or sent there in the context of certain the First World War and the Second World War, but even separately to maintain security. You also had a large number of government officials manning the political residencies and agencies, people who were at almost, if you take any photograph of a typical residency, more than half the personnel there are Indian, as you can make out from the picture. So we have had a continuity which is quite extraordinary. So when we speak of a contemporary relationship, we have to take into account that it is a continuous, unbroken, an extremely substantial relationship. Looking at India from the Gulf side, this was the only place they knew. This was your leisure center, this was your health center, this was your education center. Very often the British, unhappy with various nationalist movements in different parts of West Asia, would exile the people to Bombay. Bombay had a thriving Arabic language press, and with much of the knowledge relating to the outside world came to these people because they lived in Bombay. This was the only place they knew. Large numbers of people lived. Every prominent family of the Gulf used to have a branch of the family in Bombay to manage the trade. All the foodstuffs. I in fact inform people that at Sur, you have the remains of Harappa, a continuation, a linkage between Harappa civilization and the Arabian Peninsula. What did they find, this Franco-Italian expedition? They found at Sur, at the area called Ras Al Hind, they found pots containing grain. They found shreds of cotton cloth, and they found beads. They found an ivory comb, and they found a necklace which had some gold. Look at the three items: foodstuffs, clothing, and items of gracious living. These three items today constitute 80% of India's exports to this region. What an extraordinary continuum. So it is in this context that we have to see that there is no occasion when our relationship was not substantial. And it is not as if it is government led. It is already substantial. In fact, when I reached UAE as ambassador in 2007, look at the situation. UAE was the number four supplier of oil to India. It had the largest, second largest Indian community. It was the number one trade partner, a number one export destination for India then and even today. So I asked myself, what am I to do? I mean, I was an ambassador with nothing to do, because we were already at the highest level in terms of our relationship. And therefore, I focused initially on promoting investments and joint ventures. And later on, because of the 2008 collapse of the global economy, I shifted to culture, to familiarize young Emiratis with various aspects of Indian culture, which their parents and grandparents knew about, but they did not. So we had art exhibitions of modern and contemporary Indian art. We had film festivals so that they would see our art-winning films, our award-winning films. And we used to have a large number of dialogues and encounters at popular level. So I'm just suggesting to you that this is, without taking into account the continuum, the continuity, we would fail to understand. It is not as if that there is a knight in shining armor who arrived and built up the relationship. It's already very substantial. Now, there is one difference, and that difference is that the Cold War divided us politically. To go back a little bit, when we speak of West Asia, you use the term Middle East, but as you know, the term we use in India is West Asia, which embraces West Asia, North Africa, but it's West Asia. We had initially very substantial ties with Saudi Arabia. And in fact, King Saud visited India in 55, and Nehru visited Saudi Arabia in 56. But then the Egyptian Revolution brought about a divide in West Asia between the secular republics, secular socialist nationalist republics, and the traditional monarchies led by Saudi Arabia. In this context, in the context of the competition that had emerged within West Asia, between the traditional monarchies that had shifted to the West and the republics that were closer at that time to the Soviet Union, you had an ideological divide, which is referred to as the Arab Cold War. In India, we tended to be closer to the republics as against the monarchies. Therefore, the bonhomie that we had with Saudi Arabia was actually transferred to Egypt, and then we welcomed each and every revolution that happened. 1958 Iraq, 1962 Yemen, then Syria, and then of course Libya in 1970. So you have India supporting the Republic. Saudi Arabia moved away. In the context of the Cold War, what happened? Their military relationship was with the United States and with Pakistan. So this became the triangular relationship. The Gulf countries, which were not yet shaped, the British had not yet withdrawn. United States on the one hand, Pakistan on the other, managing the security of the region. India not present. Therefore, you had that divide. That divide is crucial for our understanding in relation to what happened subsequently. Because at that time, it was Pakistan that dominated the defense and security landscape. It provided personnel for training and indeed for security. 25,000 Pakistani soldiers were actually located in Saudi Arabia between 68 and 88 till they were removed. and Pakistani pilots used to provide training and their technicians used to provide the services because the equipment supplied to the Gulf and to Pakistan was the same, except that American personnel would have been more expensive. Pakistanis filled that space. India was not present. Therefore, India got elbowed out of the Gulf in the political and security area. This changed in 2001. It took about 10 years after the end of the Cold War to rebuild the relationship in the political area. Why did it take 10 years? Because you recall the 1990s was a very turbulent period, both in India and in the region. Saddam Hussein had occupied Kuwait, and you had, therefore, the first Gulf War, the sanctions inspections regime, the no-fly zones, the dual containment against Iraq and Iran, on the one hand. And in Saudi Arabia itself, you had the stroke that felled King Fahad bin Abdulaziz. There was a jostling in the royal family of how to handle this crisis. There was the beginning of extremist assaults on the kingdom in Riyadh and in Dammam in 1995-96. And India was, of course, declared bankrupt in 1990. We had a coalition government. And then, of course, we had Devegowda and Gujral and the first Vajpayee government. It's only in 1999. Saudi Arabia sorts out the royal family issues. India sorts out the political issues and the kingdom takes the initiative to reach out to India. I want to share with you a personal anecdote. In 1997, we got the first hint in 1997. Mm-hmm. Salim Sherwani, Minister of State, goes to Saudi Arabia in connection with something connected with Hajj, maybe Hajj or Umrah, whatever. I had not yet joined the Gulf Division. I joined the Gulf Division in January 1998, and I get the minutes of his meeting with Crown Prince Abdullah bin Abdulaziz. As he enters, the Crown Prince says, "Why has India forgotten us?" And I told myself, "This is it. They are stretching out their hand to us." And this is where I sensed it immediately because I'd been there. I served in Jeddah for 4 years. I'd been in Iraq. I'd been in Yemen, etc., Kuwait. So I sensed immediately that they are signaling to us a new relationship. No promises at this stage. But this is a very crucial sentence which you have to grab. So I take over as the Gulf head in 1998. I have only the 6 countries of the GCC, Iraq and Yemen under me. And I can focus on this relationship. So this is what happened. 1999, you find that they are talking to us about building the relationship. In year 2000, their Minister of State for Foreign Affairs, Madani, comes to India. I accompany him. I'm already ambassador, but there is no joint secretary. So I come back with him and sit in my old room and I function like the joint secretary I was before I left. So I'm both ambassador and joint secretary. I go with him to Mr. Jaswant Singh. He hands over the invitation to Mr. Jaswant Singh and says, "We want you to visit India." And this is, again, it picks up from what had been signaled to us earlier.
Yes.
They couldn't do it after that because 1998, you had a political turmoil in the country. 2001, January 2001, Jaswant Singh visits Saudi Arabia and we rebuild the political relationship. How is this done? He sits with Saud Al-Faisal, Prince Saud Al-Faisal. The first thing the prince does is he reads a written statement in English. He reads it out, setting out the kingdom's position on Jammu and Kashmir.
Okay.
The issue of Jammu and Kashmir. And when he finishes, my minister replies, "I do not disagree with a single sentence or phrase in your remarks." The second thing the prince does is he tells us, "We value our relations with India. We will not look at these ties on the basis of our relations with any other country." Okay. What are the two messages that we have got? Number one, that yes, we have been estranged. And yes, There is the issue of Jammu and Kashmir that has divided us. We have tended to take a position in support of the Pakistani posture. We are removing that. We also recognize that there are, because of lack of engagement, too many cobwebs in the way of our relationship. Let's get rid of those cobwebs and make a fresh start. We will not look at our relationship through the prism of our ties with any other country. These two messages are given. After that, the two ministers talk for 3 hours, removing this and build a personal rapport and also build the basis of going forward in this regard. Right? So this is where the narrative through the first decade of this century is how this political opening then evolves in 2010. From 2006, King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz comes to India, chief guest at Republic Day. He signs the Delhi Declaration, which spells out that the two countries will set up a strategic energy partnership. If you read that document, it is largely economic and energy-based in character. It doesn't talk about a strategic partnership. It talks about a strategic energy partnership. The kingdom was interested in India because of the high growth rates that we were showing. We had become major buyers of oil. And obviously, Saudi Arabia was then a number one supplier to us. And it is a number one supplier today. And India was the land of promise. IT, telecommunications, space, a very talented community. The shift began in the recruitment of Indians from blue-collar workers to professionally qualified people, alongside massive increase in the Indian people's recruitment into the region as a whole. So we have a strategic energy partnership. 2006. 2010, Dr. Manmohan Singh comes and we sign the Riyadh Declaration that speaks of a strategic partnership. What happened in those 4 years? Very dramatically, the same city where you are located, 2008, is the attack at Mumbai. November 2008 is the attack. What is the significance? The significance is this. Till then, despite in the minds of the people of the region, the Pakistani indication that the issue of Jammu and Kashmir is the unfinished business of partition, and that is why you have extremism and terrorism, nothing to do with us. It's an indigenous movement linked with Jammu and Kashmir. So every time I would make a presentation on jihad, I would say Jammu and Kashmir is not the issue. Jammu and Kashmir is an issue I can discuss. But what do I do with jihad? Jihad is a scourge. It's a scourge. But they didn't buy that argument. Mm-hmm. Then Bombay changed everything. Because when you were sitting in front of your television screens in Riyadh and in Abu Dhabi and in Muscat, what did you see? This is an assault upon Mumbai. Nothing to do with Jammu and Kashmir. It has a jihadi assault. It has very clearly come from Karachi. And you can't move from Karachi unless you are state-sponsored. So it's a state-sponsored attack. The concern in the region is explosive. Because they now realize, today Mumbai, tomorrow us. Exactly what I used to say. I used to say that jihad respects no national border. If today they are attacking India, they could attack you. Do recall in 2001, they'd attacked Red Fort and the parliament and the Jammu and Kashmir assembly. So, you know, absolutely. But we had not been able to make that headway. We did that now. We didn't have to. It is something. That is how the scene. I was in Abu Dhabi in those days, and I recall the real panic in the region. Look at the map. All of them have very long coastlines. All of them are closer to Karachi than Bombay is. And India, of course, has a huge navy. And yet, we were assaulted. Gruesomely assaulted. Random attack, nearly 200 people dead, serving no apparent useful purpose, no strategic purpose. Nothing connected with the issue of Jammu and Kashmir. They were now on our side. So the route forward with regard to India was counter-terrorism. they now became our partners with regard to counterterrorism. And this is the key. This is what changed everything. And therefore, the strategic partners. I gave you such a long harangue to place the present relationship in perspective. The history, continuity, strengthened during the British Raj, the very strong pro-India connection, the break in the political relations due to the Cold War in the Arab world, the recovery of this relationship through the decade, the first decade of this, and you culminate with the strategic partnership with Dr. Manmohan Singh. So now you ask me, is this the best time? What happened is, Mr. Narendra Modi appeared to give considerable time and attention to West Asia, particularly the Gulf countries, through a very robust interaction in 2015-2016. And most of us believed, including myself, that this was the, he's taking forward the strategic partnership into India now shaping a role as a strategic role player in as a security provider in the region through diplomacy. Because do recall, the region's security was deteriorating by the day. And India, my mind, had very crucial long-term interest in the region. And what did you see? India had at that stage, if you look at the middle, say, 1 year into the Modi one, you have 8.5 million Indians living in the Gulf. 8.5 million. And do recall again, every man in the Gulf supports 4 people at home. So 40 million Indians are directly benefiting from this. And the remittances, which were about a third of our oil bill, was met by remittances in foreign exchange. No effort by government is happening. Positive. Number one, energy partnership. Crucial. 70-80% of our oil coming from the 6 countries of the GCC, Iran, Iraq at that time. So energy, trade, number, even when the oil prices had started going down, they were still in the top 3 or 4 of our trade partners. In the first 10, 4 countries of the region were in the first 10 in terms of trade. And we were talking, and you will remember Prime Minister Modi's visit to Iran, which became a tripartite meeting because the president of Afghanistan showed up as well.
Yes.
And therefore, you had a logistical connectivity agreement, development of Chabahar, the connection with Zahedan and with Afghanistan, linking with the Afghanistan network. And then there was talk about Central Asia and the international north-south transit corridor, which would take the connection up to Moscow and then link up with Western Europe. So there was a logistical aspect of great strategic value as far as India is concerned. So there was a sense that we are now we are crucially transforming our, which is a natural continuum in the way I have presented it to you.
Yes.
It's a natural continuum going forward. You know, economic relationship, community-based relationship, energy relationship, becoming a strategic partnership now shaping for India. This continued till January 2017, when the Crown Prince of Abu Dhabi came to India as chief guest at our Republic Day. Do recall the document. By that time, we have signed about 7 or 8 or 10 documents. The PM has been to Iran, he has been to Israel, there have been return visits, there have been 3 visits exchanged with UAE, and then, of course, the visit with Saudi Arabia, 2 or 3 visits with Saudi Arabia. Crown Prince also showed up here. So we've had a very robust engagement, and we have access by that time to at least 10 joint statements. That was then. So 18, 19, 20, 3 years. 3 years later, to my mind, it is a blank slate. Nothing was done. And Modi too, to my mind, has effectively given up all interest in foreign policy. See, it is now when I look back, I realize how badly I misunderstood. I actually believed that there was a strategic thought behind this engagement, that there is a pattern. I used to put the joint statements together and see a pattern of security cooperation, of maritime cooperation, cyber security, etc., emerging as a pattern. And I wrote articles at that time in several places saying that India is going to be a security provider. I'm not saying that I'm replacing the United States. The United States has done more damage to the region than anyone else. It's a destructive force. It's not a force for stability. My concern is that largely as a result of US intervention, the region is in extreme danger and it is facing a region-wide conflagration. So I now believe, and this is my last part of my answer to your first question, I now believe that we are today entirely focused on reshaping the domestic scenario, reshaping the idea of India, reshaping the institutions of India. The India that I grew up with and which you have had a glimpse of in your life so far is being refashioned on the basis of an ideology that animates the political leadership of our country today. There is no space here for foreign policy. And therefore, I speak to you with the deepest possible disappointment that we had all the... because, you see, Mr. Modi doesn't begin anything. Foreign policy is never a beginning. It's a process. And the way I sketched it out to you very briefly...
Absolutely.
So this could be part of a book. I've mentioned very briefly that he is the legatee of an extraordinarily rich achievement by a wide variety of leaders over several decades to reach that phase. And he picked it up. He really did pick it up. But now I feel that even those interactions, because see, unless you have a strategic vision, I'm going to speak now in broader terms, for every foreign policy, you need a vision. A vision means, what do I want? I'm not talking about the larger vision for the world. Oh, India, great country, and all that. Say, for example, focus on West Asia. What does India want to achieve in West Asia? Then second part of your vision is a strategy. A strategy to achieve the vision. And a strategy must be accompanied by an action plan. That this is what I will do. So a vision is a vision for, say, 10 years. A strategy is to realize that vision. And an action plan is usually a ruling plan for 2 years and refreshed as we go along. There is no vision. There is therefore no strategy. And therefore there is no action plan. You lurch from day to day. So today, if you ask me, my own understanding of the scenario is that there has been no change. The opportunity that had emerged in 2015, 2017 was perhaps never there and certainly is today lost. What was the nature of our engagements before that? It used to be that defined by two words, bilateral and transactional. Bilateral means I have a relationship with a specific country, doesn't matter where it is geographically located, and that country has that relationship with me. This enabled me to build ties with Saudi Arabia and Iran, and with Israel, and with Qatar, and with Bahrain, a wide variety of countries suiting each other's interests.
Yes.
This was bilateral. And transactional, in the sense that I give you something, you give me something. That made sense up to a point. But post-2011, when the region is in such turmoil and there is a grave danger of a region-wide conflict, this luxury of being bilateral and transactional is no longer available to us. That was the time we should have shaped an alternative approach to the region, either on our own or along with other like-minded partners, Japan, China, Korea, etc., would have been very viable role players at that time because they shared similar concerns, and we would have tried to see how we can build a security scenario, if initially a peace process, bringing together Saudi Arabia and Iran, and over a period of time, I had given myself a five-year period of promoting a regional security arrangement. All of that, none of that has happened. And therefore, my answer to you is that I see today a situation of deep-seated disappointment rather than a situation which I would say was a high point in the bilateral relationship. I don't believe that is there at all.